Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let me welcome you to the sixth session with the title Humanity, the last session of this very interesting conference, which I am sure you all enjoyed. Please allow me to announce to you two last-minute changes. First of all, the lecture by Dr. Laos Nicholas with the title Greek Ontology as the Basis of an Alternative Strategic Vision of Globality will not be presented. And instead of that, at the same time, we are going to have the lecture by Dr. Natsikas Nektarios, which is the last lecture. Another last-minute change is that our moderator, Mr. Kosteletos, will not be able to be with us during all the session. He has some engagement after his lecture, which he will present. And therefore, it is my great pleasure to present to you the moderator which will take his place. His name is Professor Nikos Michael Vayiakakos. She's an economist by education. He's a human resources advisor and educator for more than 35 years in Greece and abroad. He is specialized in the phenomenology of human systems and in systemic psychology, serving as the head of the Hellenic Chamber of the International Systemic Constellation Association. He is also an author in the domain of personal and systemic development and the publisher of the Alphabet Editions. He is also a member of the organizing committee of this conference. Dear Nikos, please take over. The microphone.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman, for this wonderful opportunity you give me to moderate a part of our conference. It is truly my honor. So, we're entering the last session, the last strand of our conference, which is devoted to humanity, with Mr. Dimitrios Kosteletos, who will be our first lecturer. Mr. Kosteletos is an architect of the National Technical University of Athens, and his office has conducted a range of architectural and urban projects accompanied by appropriate publications. Mr. Kosteletos is well known for his thorough presentations, bridging together different domains of creation like art, science, ordinary and spiritual life. Our speaker now will share his reflections for the 21st century beyond the anthropocentric view. So, Mr. Kosteletos, the floor of our conference is yours, please.
It's a pleasure to join you. You hear me well? A good day for everybody. So my topic today is reflections on human thought for the 21st century. I'm so glad to open this session of humanities. I have a subtitle, Beyond the Anthropocentric View, and this issue concerns me during the last 20, maybe more years. But today, I would like to present you just a familiarize you with a brief introduction to this great topic. I will speak in five steps so I can be clear enough to what I would like to say. The first step has to do with the question, the problem. As we enter a globalized world under the frame of technology and biotechnology, that is very well known to everybody. As we enter this era, The question for a holistic thinking is an agony for a view that encounters and experiences and contemplates for the century to come on the ordinary everyday life in an appropriate, I don't say right or wrong, but adequate way that praxis itself will reaffirm. So what I want to just to keep in mind from this point is that the new thought we have to integrate in for the 21st century has to stand upon all traditions that realize and speak of an inadequacy, so to speak. This inadequacy is for the Greeks aporia, no passes, for the Buddhists is ignorance, for the Jews is a kind of sort of guilt or fall, for the Hindus is maya or illusion, but they all speak for some such a sort of, such a kind of a problem to see clear and in a whole way. So for us, the people of the West, we have to overcome two major things. The thought in West always comes in two patterns. The first is the pattern of the window. We see as if something is there out of a frame, out of a window, and this is a philosophical, let's just say, way of thinking. And the other one is a way of thinking through mirroring, through a mirror. It's a kind of thinking that speaks of through projections. This is the psychological, so to speak, way of thinking. These two ways of thinking, we have to integrate them, to overcome them, so we can join the, we can fill the gap that was made at the beginning of the modern era. So this is my first point. The second one, this demand for holistic thinking was total view, it was set by Plato at first, at the seventh chapter of the Republic, when the recitation of the allegory of the cave comes to an end, a question as well as a drama on the direct viewing of the good, agathon, this source, cause, or limit for every intelligible. Agathon, that is beyond essence, as the luminous part of being, is related to a sort of an identification, to an idea, a sudden glimpse towards cosmos. What I want to keep for this second point is that agathon we seek for is not a value or a virtue. Values or virtues are very important. There are presupposes, but it's not exactly what we seek for. Because as you can see, every tradition, every religion, every way of thinking, every philosophical, psychological, or scientific has its own values. And so we have to integrate them in this globalized world, which is coming and has the global as well as the local, I don't say national, in his mind. Now let's go to a third point. During the post-Renaissance anthropocentric paradigm, the crux point concerning truth was strongly shifted from nature, that was the crux point for the ancient era, not only for the Greeks, but from the rest of the ancient world, or God, which was the main figure of the medieval period, to the Cartesian eye, otherwise to the eye of the beholder. The initiative, so to speak, general frame set by the anthropocentric view standpoint at the beginning was the perceptivity, was proptiki, was the perception, the seeing under proptiki, under perspective, which is to say what makes prominent was what is and what is placed at the first place was actually what matters for men. After that, an issue of great importance for modernity was the nomination of the subject, individual or collective, conscious or unconscious, the prominent topos, the starting point for perception, thought, desire, volition, or aesthetic judgment was the subject. But what I want to put in mind here in this third point is that this idea of the subject is an idea that is so problematic that means what I want to say with the word problematic is that poses questions, is that what is this subject which is in the middle of the anthropocentric area? It's a social subject. It's a subject of spirit, a Hegelian, so to speak. It's a subject of doubt, a Cartesian one. It's a transcendental subject of a Kantian under a categorical imperative. So it's a subject of volition. It's a subject of a power of for will, as Nietzsche said. It's a subject of the conscious or the unconscious, or it's a subject of subvertive, so to speak, as Lacan said, trying to combine the linguistic and the unconscious under the famous phrase that the unconscious speaks like a language, as a structure of a language. So what is this subject of the modern era? This is the first thing we have to overcome. There is not such a thing in itself. However, the logic for the concept of a main foundation, like the ancient physical or the medieval supernatural or transcendental, this concept has not been abandoned by the modern era. It always haunts the 20th century way of thinking as economical way of production, Marx, psychological, pleasure principle, Freud, anthropological, optimal diversity, Claude Lévi-Strauss, or linguistic, the horizon of the language, as Claude Saussure, Wittgenstein, the world is my language, the limits of the world are the limits of my language. What I want to keep in mind from this third point is that although the idea of the foundation is strong, the ultimate foundation is a problematic idea, does not exist. We cannot orientate our thought now through the one unique or main foundation, as the 20th century did. Plato gives a good example of foundation in time in Timaeus, when he speaks of hora, a receptacle, a kind of a place that can invite the whole cosmic material and gives him a prosaic, so to speak. This space, not of one space, not of one entity, but in the sense of the all-pervading area, is very powerful idea to, if you want to speak of the foundation. So now I enter a fourth point I want to give you, to make you familiar to. So if we are now in a way to pass, to orient ourselves in a new way of thinking, and we have already in mind the ancient opening to nature, the medieval opening to God, the anthropocentric opening to man, what is cosmos is the new foundation, both material and spiritual, is the last foundation we have to come through and abandon as well. What is important for us is to consider the inadequacy of a romantic turn into nature, God or man. What is to seek for is nature's coming back in everyday life, God's or man's coming back as sacredness trains in the presence of the other. Cosmos is not material or spiritual, optic or energetic, formative or formless, known or unknown, objective or subjective. It is not under our control, volition or desire, even under our presentation. So what I want to say is when, for instance, we speak for technology, we can speak in the old fashion that technology is something neutral and it depends upon us, upon man, if it has a bad or a good orientation towards technology. It's not like that. The new idea is that technology is like the air. You don't have control over the air. There may be a small breath that just touches your face, but the air may be so catastrophic. It doesn't depend on you. You have to do something with the air. You are part and parcel of the cosmos, the air. It's not just on you. We have to take this responsibility for man, and we have to open man to cosmos. This cosmos, it is a cosmos that has no, it is a cosmos that has no, I have to open the window a little. It's a cosmos that has no center or periphery. That is to say, it's a cosmos that has not a privileged starting point to hang upon. So, what is the way we just appreciate this cosmos? This is my last fifth point I want to speak about. Now, we are also aware of idea, not only as a great principle for unification or fragmentation, oneness or multiplicity, wholeness or partiality, as it was before, but idea as an open systematic, a productive total thinking that runs through all the domains of art, science, religion, love and pleasure, politics, ethics, concerning a poetical becoming. It is, what is this systematic, open systematic? I give you an example. Suppose you are one day, you are at home, and you have some guests, and time is goes on, it's late, you want to eat something. There is nothing at home, you haven't cooked something good. So you say, let's
excuse order. Excuse me, Kosteletos, I'm very sorry for interrupting you. But there are only 3 minutes left.
Ah, there are 3 minutes. So, okay. I will close. Thank you. Okay.
Thank you.
I just leave this example and I will move on. So this idea, what is this open systematic? This open systematic fits synthetically. It is the very simplicity. It is ordinary orientation. It is holistic, not totalitarian view. It is a sort of synthesis of different forms of knowledge, experience, and expression. It overcomes the antithesis between theoretical and practical. It flows without effort from concentration to expansion, from extension to profundity, from proximity to distance, from presence to absence, revealing rather degrees of tensions than rigid identifications, aims to a recognition of this rather than demanding for interpretations. It is a sort of intentional orienting, turning and clear seeing, combining perception, the perceptive, the intelligible, and the intuitive. It is open to the forthcoming. What I keep you to keep from this point is that qua is better, is rather than pourquoi. Life and death both take place in this procession opening. It's a dialogue in the limits, and when a message comes out, it is a transparent situation of the whole space that takes place there. Thanks a lot for your attention. Nomizo, it's okay now? I'm in time? I don't hear you.
Sorry. We thank you very, very much for being so precise at your time. If I may add a part of thanking you for this contribution, you opened up with your five dimensions of this holistic thinking. You opened us five dimensions. I'm sure there are going to be quite some questions for later on for you. So we will welcome your questions in the question and answer session. And thank you very much. Stay with us. I would like now to welcome our second speaker, who is Professor Kostas Gouliamos. Kostas Gouliamos is an elected rector of the European University of Cyprus, an elected regular member of the European Academy of Sciences, and honorary professor at Lanzhou City University, China. Also, Professor Gouliamos has served as a senior communication and public affairs advisor to the Greek government and to the President of the Republic of Cyprus. Our speaker now will unfold and share a most central question of our present reality. Is there any new humanism in the 21st century? So, Professor Gouliamos, the floor of our conference is yours, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speer, Chair. It's a great honor for me to participate in this extraordinary, remarkable, I would consider it, conference. UNESCO's reflection on a new humanism has been adapted in 2010, based on the hypothesis that globalization has accelerated the mingling of cultures and the rapid development of new media technologies. UNESCO's theoretical framework on new humanism has aggrandized the perspectives of social interaction. Whether or not the term new humanism has originally taken from UNESCO, it is currently emerged from the current operation of digital and quantum technology. Such a technology is the mystification of new power relations. Besides, it represents an illusory unity that, inter alia, accelerates the fragmentary genealogy of reality, as well as the annihilation and replacement of humanism in 21st century. My critical thought or analytics deconstructs both the dominant discourses pertinent to superficial consensus on a new humanism and the monolithic concepts of transhumanism and posthumanism influenced by postmodernist hermeneutics and its theoretical propositions. Some universal principles of enlightenment related to the evolution of the human species, for example, equality, freedom of thought, freedom of expression, democratic governance, and so on. In our epoch of digital, and in 10 years from now, quantum technology, are openly under the Damoclean sword of theories pertinent to eugenics and metahumanism. As we can recall, in the 70s, philosophers have spoken on the end of human being, or as Jacques Derrida put it, on the possibility of imagining consciousness without the human being. To some extent, Michel Foucault's theory, associated with the structuralist and post-structuralist movements, particularly in Words and Things in Archaeology of the Human Sciences, has influenced several theorists of the meta-humanistic perspective. Besides, in today's post-pandemic societal, political, economic, and cultural transfer, there are concerns and substantially problematic issues which are inevitably at the heart of the current discourse of metahumanism. Moreover, these issues are accelerated during the pandemic period and intensified precisely because of the politics of neoliberal globalization. Recent reports and studies have assessed the interconnection of the global digital flows and the practices of neoliberal politics. For instance, individuals are participating in globalization directly using digital platforms to learn, find work, and build personal networks. More than 1 million people have international connections on social media, and close to 500,000 take part in cross-border e-commerce. Digital platforms change the economics and politics, as well as cultural forms, increasing the flow of international interactions and transactions. Meanwhile, critical theory offers new insights into how nation states are participating in the web of digital flows, and extends our analysis, drawing on data on moral, intellectual, and political foundations, and employing more sophisticated hermeneutics and methodology. Individuals, on the other hand, are participating in globalization directly using digital platforms to learn, find work, and build personal and interpersonal networks. Some 900 million people have international connections on social media, and close to 400 million take part in cross-border e-commerce, as I said previously. The COVID-19 crisis has accelerated the digital transformation of the global economy. In any case, we experience more than any other period in of our history the operation of metahuman systems. These new emergent socio-technical systems learn how to human learning, or contribute to join human learning, and create systemic capabilities. In view of this, they change many facets of the way we think about social and cultural life, about public and private organizations, and of course, work environments. In our epoch, the breakdown of the boundaries between traditional and/or conventional praxis and digital focused ecosystems is one of the main features of the 21st biopolitics. it is not accidental that for some scholars, the brain appears to be the first collateral victim of the increasingly close relationship between humans and machines. Human memory now finds itself competing with digital memory. Dear colleagues, the so-called new enlightenment of the digital and quantum age contributes to the emergence of new species known as bio-robots. We are already surrounded by a plethora based of cyborgs, androids, teleworking, artificial intelligence, and robots. The pandemic and the post-pandemic period accelerate the digital zones. In 10 years from now, we are going to experience the quantum technology. Capitalizing on these zones, metahumanists or metahumanists believe that we should not shrink as societies as a result of methods of education or cultural concepts associated with the principles of classical enlightenment. Instead, we must integrate, as they believe, new technologies in a way that will allow the human species to go beyond what some consider as human. In essence, the cell of the metahumanistic thought and approach is the formation through technology of a common world consciousness, which they call it a new enlightenment. However, to my opinion, to my thesis, this new enlightenment is a nightmare, reminding inter alia pages of the Orwellian society. In fact, the new enlightenment is a form of nihilism and disintegration of human species to the extent that our ontological self is attempted to be de-identified from its ontological self. It is a fitting of human and non-human flaws that dehumanize according to the reflection of Deleuze and Guattari. In fact, the Guattari refers to partial subjectivity, that is subjectivity without an ecumenical conception of the human subject. I would argue, moreover, that one can easily discern this de-identification if he or she follows theories and actions of the metahumanistic movement, also known as H+. These theories and actions as derivatives of a dystopian post-industrial social environment are far removed from classical humanism, as they reject the anthropocentric and social approach while degrading the human species into one of many natural or artificial species. Allow me to conclude my speech and taking into account, you know, my previous approach by providing two, for me, critical questions. Question first, what literary and or other forms of letters and arts can be employed as cultural means towards an emotional and cognitive resistance to the ongoing artificial and instrumental ecosystem of metahumanism? And question two, how literary and or other forms of literature and art can activate, reinvent, and re-energize the mental and ontological synthesis of humanity with the aim to expose whatever makes us cyborgs and augmented humans. So thank you very, very much for your attention.
Professor Gouliamos, we thank you very much for the economy of your speech. On the other hand, you have put through some very important questions, and especially the two last ones. They are quite long as well, so we would be grateful if you could write them in the chat room or, you know, just to have it in written as well. Because I'm sure that it will steer discussion later on. Thank you again for your consistent presentation, which enables us to move forward with our next speaker. And I would like to invite and welcome Professor Stavros Oikonomidis, who is an archaeologist, adjunct professor at the Arcadia University, Glenside, USA, and director of the Greek-Albanian Archaeological Expedition at the Tri-National Zone of Prespa. As a field archaeologist, he has worked in Greece, Italy, in Middle and Near Eastern countries, and in the Balkans. Our speaker now will share his own unique perspective of connecting the Athenian paradigm with current state of consciousness. From one to many Athens towards the rediscovery of human consciousness. So, Professor Oikonomidis, we're very happy to welcome you, and the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much. I'm really happy to be here among all of you. Thank you for your invitation. And I will start saying that in his dialogue of Critias, Plato presents an outstanding description of the tradition related to the primordial past of Athens and Attica. Plato, filtering a huge number of different myths, explains the stages of the creation of the famous Asti. And even before that, he gives a geological on how Attica and Athens were formed and transformed in the remote past. But when it was that Athens was founded, we don't know. According to Plato, Athens existed already as a powerful state 10,000 years before his era. A notion like this cannot be taken as a genuine one, since the archaeological finds prove it to be mere mythology. As a matter of fact, the archaeological data so far, settlements established all over the flat valley around of what would be the first proper urban nucleus of Athens. The slopes of the Acropolis were inhabited by that time too. Old memories of the classical citizens of Athens would be recalled under mythological vestiges. Theseus, the first king of the Euctimenon Ptolieithron, was the settler, the ctitor, and the eponymous hero responsible for the creation of the first Athenian synecismos, inviting people from the valley closer to the Acropolis hill. It is to these collected satellite settlements of the valley that Athens due her name in plural form, Athens and not Athen. Besides, we mustn't forget other ancient Athenian versions of the foundation of the city, all of them extravagant because mythological. Athena fights Poseidon, gaining power over the city, which is to take her divine name, or King Codros, who half dragon, half human, reigns all over the city, much before Theseus. Other very old memories mixed and fused with myths and local legends talk about the older inhabitants who were the Pelasgians, thrown away from Athens by the Ionian tribes who flooded Attica at some time, maybe during the second millennium BCE. No one can really be certain with dates regarding the foundation of Athens, trying to keep walking firmly from mythos to logos and not the contrary. It is certain, though, that goddess Athena's name is to be identified as of Mycenaean origin, Atana Potinia, a goddess of war and courage, common as worship in both Minoan and Mycenaean contexts, and symbolically represented as an eight-shaped Mycenaean shield, according to the transliterated linear B tablets and to the related frescoes discovered in palatial contexts of the late Bronze Age. But if the prehistory of Athens is part of a greater complex of myths and half-invented stories due to political propaganda of later centuries ahead, Athens' history is well known, especially for her Periclean times, the so-called golden age of philosophy and democracy, of the arts and of the sciences. Still wandering through the centuries that passed by after that immense big bang of glory of the human civilization and fulfillment, we realize that there are dark corners of Athenian history still to be explored and studied, since between the golden age of Athens and today's Athens, centuries of neglected or sporadic knowledge, if any at all. Frankish Athens doesn't share any obvious urban and aesthetic characteristics with Athens of Socrates, nor Venetian or Ottoman Athens is in any way correlated to any Asti and polis. Conditions of history transformed Athens throughout the centuries, in every aspect, though the never-dying memory of the ancient polis played a significant role for its identification as an idea. As a unique phenomenon in history of civilization, Athens, like all the demoi of the 5th and the 4th centuries of the Hellenic world, was referred to her citizens, polites, and not to her material entity. It is for this reason we do have demos Athenaeon or demos Ephesion, which is the demos of the Athenians, the demos of the Ephesians, etc., instead of the demos of Athens or of Ephesus, etc. The citizens go first. The city is its people and not its buildings, which means that the polis is primarily considered to be made out of the ecclesia to the The polis is already in the world and understood as an idea, as something less material and more spiritual. It is spiritual Athens then, and not just a three-dimensional complex of constructions that could be temples, public and private spaces, industries, workshops, residences, and theaters. It is the idea, the idea of the harmonic coexistence of its citizens, the electors, the thinkers, and the statesmen, counted that much in the classical times. The Parthenon, the Hephaestion, the Odeon and the Gymnasia, the Agora and the public cemetery were considered then nothing more than symbols of a collective work of the citizens. Ekphrasis of this majestic productivity of the democracy and of Ergani herself in the Heraclitean version of truth, it is topos and chronos, space and time, that decide for the fate of every existence. In order to have something according to the Ionian, which means so much Athenian also, Heraclitos, there are these two eternal prerogatives giving the possibility of existence. In our case of symbolic Athens, here topos, the polis itself as expression of the collective work of its citizens, and here chronos, understood as a permanently changing reality, extent beyond the historical time and space. Place is superior to things in place, so that being in place is being in something superior, said Aristotle. A city, not a place for its people and their products, is the main idea of Athens in the antiquity, in the Middle Ages, and in the early modern times, where protagonists are the humans, the classical idea of atomon. It is this the greatest success of classical age Athens, to put in the center of the universe each single human being, and to analyze it methodically, extensively, and scientifically. For the first time ever in the history of planet Earth, the individual becomes the point of observation and analysis. There is no more room for the gods, since the atomon, the individual, the citizen of the polis, is and must remain the epicenter and at the same time a potential god who is able enough to understand the difference between mythos and logos, who is realistic, pragmatic, analytical, and capable of determining the aetia, the reasons of the action in the cosmos, in the end, viewed as a contracted maximum. To the eyes of medieval people, the above seen as hubris against the god, but it was not. It was only the apotheosis of the microcosm of the atomon hidden inside the macrocosm. Furthermore, the invention of the right criteria of how to understand the human being with the analysis of its soul and with the interest, for the first time ever, about our existence in the wider frame of the cosmos. Products of democratic Athens are all this, values that cannot be imprisoned in any chronology or historical date. Indeed, in the obscure and still unknown to us centuries of material decadence of Athens, the sperm of that role played by her in the classical past found proliferous minds all over Europe for centuries afterwards. It is only in the early modern times that Athenian ideas, taking shape in the texts of cultural leaders of Europe, such as Pliton, Hermonymus, Lascaris and Halkocondylis, Mirandola, Bruno, Cusa, Erasmus, Reuchlin, Capnion, Moore, Milton, and hundreds more having a proper revival, if not reanimation, of the ideal in the world. Concepts like harmony, aesthetic, perfection, perfect balance, the metron, democracy, golden number, the mathematics of the spheres, atomon, liberty, live into this revival of spiritual Athens after a long time of hibernation. It is enough in order to understand better to mention the decisive influence Athens had over the shaping of the first modern republics of the so-called Western world, with their first acts of declaration of freedom and their first acts of constitution. Today, these values, no doubt, are under risk, though the only ones preserving real interest for the citizen, the individual's well-being inside a republic. It is just to remember Athens again, not only the one that once gave the gifts of this well-being, but its multiple reflections over the political existence of the individual. Today, the industrialization of minds, technocracy, and mechanization are offending our cultural integrity daily. Instead of atomon, we have the concept of the mass production in every imaginable field. Mechanic minds, leading mechanic components, not of republics anymore, but of hyper states of total neoliberal globalism. We have less Athens and more imperium. In order to have back Athens, described as metaphysical tool for the public well-being, we must return to its most fundamental axioms, which are the possibility of the formation of a community composed by independent individuals, atoma, based on a rationalized general will, and the reintegration of the philosophical thought in this action, the re-evaluation of the dialectics of fair exchange of political and other ideas, the revival of the classical semiotics of what citizen politis means. We should take the region itself as that which comes to us, according to Heidegger, and in this way we should go and meet the prototype of Athens as that region, in time and space, appearing to ourselves only through an experience of spacing, as Derrida says, modern thoughts that have been formed closely to ancient views. Athens is not only one, but many. There is still the prototype whose symbolic values have duration in space and time. It is upon us to prefer to stay on its superficial copy. It is critical to watch the image, the icona of this Athens of the citizens, and not only of her buildings, letting prevail above all others the open-minded ecclesia, to them all. Among the many versions of Athens, the touristic, the archaeological, or Athens of the many bad reproductions of herself, it is political and philosophical and scientific Athens that I'm talking about. And I have just described you today as a model of thought, political freedom, and the city where separation of the individual from the anonymous masses takes place. Thank you very much for your attention.
Professor Oikonomidis, we thank you extremely for your elaboration of these great ideas. And to be frank with you, by listening carefully to your lecture, I felt like a nucleus inside of me, you know, coming more and more open. Those ideas, those not only philosophical ideas and axioms, but also words, the atomon idea, topos, chronos, icona, you said at the end, all their sparkling things inside us. So I believe that in the Q&A session that we will have at the end of our lectures, I think that you will define more things for us.
Absolutely. Thank you again.
Thank you again. Thank you. Absolutely. Thank you for your contribution. Now, now we're going to have an interval, a break from 2:30 precisely. We're about 5 minutes before that. And during the interval, it has been organized an interview of Professor Kalemis, am I right? A short interview by our journalist. So I invite you to watch this interview of Professor Kalemis. We will be back again in 3 o'clock, 1500 hours, just after the break, with Assistant Professor Nasikas starting up his presentation and lecture. In the meantime, you may please write, inscribe your questions in the Q&A section of our Zoom system here, and we will receive them accordingly. Well, thank you very much indeed. Please join the Professor Kalemis interview by our journalist. Thank you very much. See you again, 3 o'clock. So I'm notified that we need a couple of more minutes for Professor Kalemis and our journalist to be ready for the interview. Please, for your patience, in 2-3 minutes, we will have the interview. Thank you very much. Stay with us. So, Mrs. Korovesi, I believe that you're ready for your interview.
Yes, of course.
Please take the floor together with Professor Kalemis, please.
Thank you. Dear Professor, welcome. Thank you for joining us at this short interview. Yesterday, at the second day of the conference, you moderated the fourth session under the environment topic, as well as you delivered a speech on clean energy technologies for the development of islands by quoting the Greek examples. Which were the highlights of this fourth session, and why the environment topic is considered one of the main pillars of such a conference, which is called Man and His Creations?
Good morning from the University of West Africa. It is my pleasure to be with you again. Yesterday we have a very interesting and really interdisciplinary session. We have joined efforts from various, let's say, specialities as far as it concerns the climate change. We have 6 presentations. For example, we have presentations from energy policy and climate change from Professor Maniatis. We have a more technical presentation concerning the clean energy solutions for remote islands. Accordingly, we have a presentation concerning the impact of nanotechnology in order to reduce the CO2 emissions by the 17-year building materials. Also, we have a presentation by Dr. Riffler concerning the first ever AMD treatment and pigment production plan to restore Monday Creek. There's also another very innovative presentation concerning the interaction between human health and ecosystem and how we can minimize the, let's say, the climate changes through the use of integrated analysis of sustainable olive cultivation. And last but not least was the very interesting presentation about the forecasting the meteorological parameters and how these parameters can give us some ideas how to minimize, let's say, the air pollution. As an example, the speaker give us the idea how in Salamina the Greek have the possibility to battle against the Persian troops. It was a very interesting session, and we believe that based on all this information, we are able to start supporting green and blue small development in order to minimize the impact of energy sector and the climate change. As you know, the energy sector is the major contributor as far as concerns the greenhouse gas emissions. And we believe that it's now the time to start minimizing all these effects. And yes, we can stop this negative climate change for the next years.
Mm-hmm. Dear Professor, thank you very much for your answer and your analytical remarks. And I would like now to proceed to the Athens College Athens project, an idea that was born at the University of West Attica, in which you serve as a vice rector since September 2019. Which actions have been made during the last year for the extroversion of the university through the Athens College Athens project? And how do you find, in general, the vision of the project and, of course, the idea of the conference? And something additional, if you have any future plans in this framework.
I shall start from the end, let's say. I think that the idea of this conference is very clever, very innovative. It is a very good idea, very innovative, to try to join efforts between all the Athens all around the globe. It was Mr. George Psathas that has started this idea, and our university, of course, supports all these steps. We hoped that we have more, let's say, more contacts to be together here in Athens and not using the computers, in order to exchange ideas, to know better each other, and start collaboration between all the people that are living and working in various Athens all around the world. In any case, it is a very good idea. With all the contributors, all the participants, either work or live in Athens all around the planet, and it's very good idea to know each other and try to prepare collaborative plans for various sectors of our life. For example, we can join efforts to tackle, let's say, the climate change, or to minimize the energy problems that are very serious for many countries. And I believe that it's a very promising conference, and I hope that we can repeat it in next year or the next 2 years, and try to make it something that will happen every 2 years, for example, and in better conditions, of course, hoping that this pandemic will stop soon.
Thank you, Mr. Professor, and I wish you all the best to your future endeavors. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you very much.
So, are we ready to begin? Are we ready to commence back? Mr. Chairman, Mr. Kalokerinos?
I think we can start. First of all, let me congratulate Dr. Nasikas for his election as a professor in the Greek Army Academy.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much.
Okay, allow me to introduce Dr. Nektarios Nasikas, who is an assistant professor at the Hellenic Army Academy, also serving as the founding director of the Hellenic Foundation for Research and Innovation. He's an internationally experienced academic and researcher in the fields of material science and engineering, as well as a key policymaker, helping Greece to build a knowledge-based economy by utilizing research and innovation outcomes. Well, our speaker now will share his extensive hands-on experience in policymaking in Greece and the EU, and in particular, building a knowledge-based economy by supporting the excellent academic and research ecosystem of Greece. So, Professor Nasikas, the floor is yours, please.
Thank you very much, Mr. Vayiakakos, for this kind introduction and for the kind words that you shared about myself. I'm extremely honored to participate in this very, very important conference with so many important participants. It is also my pleasure to be able to describe the work that we have done towards creating an institution, a novel institution for the very first time in Greece, in order to help build, as you said, a knowledge-based economy. And we are trying to do that by supporting the excellent academic and research ecosystem of Greece. I will start sharing my screen with you now and start my presentation in order to give you a better understanding about what we are trying to do at the Hellenic Foundation for Research and Innovation. The title is Building a Knowledge-Based Economy by Supporting the Excellent Academic and Research Ecosystem of Greece. As many of you know, the Hellenic Foundation is a public foundation operating under private law. It is now being supervised by the Deputy Minister of Development and Investments, who is responsible for research and technology. What HFRI does is actually providing funds through open and competitive calls following a very, I would say, rigorous and really, really strict peer review scientific evaluation. We follow very, very strict guidelines because, as you can see below, we have the unique, I would say, privilege, but also the huge responsibility of funding the whole spectrum of Greek academics. And on the one end of that, this spectrum, we have PhD students who we support through scholarships. Somewhere in between, we have postdoctoral fellows. And this is really, really important because, as you know, Greece has suffered a lot through a huge financial crisis. And now is also facing the COVID-19 pandemic. We have seen Greece paying a really, really high toll in what we call brain drain, which has caused severe implications in keeping a robust and internationally competitive academic ecosystem in Greece. On the, let's say, further side of the spectrum, we have faculty members and researchers who are actually the backbone of the Greek academic and research community. Actually, they are the ones who will shape and will educate the scientists of the future. So actually the future of Greece itself. We do not only provide funding and support for the academic personnel, but we also provide support in order for the foundations and the universities and the research centers to be able to acquire what we say high cost research equipment of strategic importance. Because not only the personnel is under severe stress, but when you want to be competitive in an international level, your scientific equipment must also follow the international, let's say, state of the art. So it's really important to not just have the ability to acquire scientific equipment, which is, let's say, for one or two labs, but of strategic importance that we will give that competitive advantage for the universities or the research centers that will host that equipment. HFRI also promotes actions for science and society programs in order to, let's say, roll out the results of the research projects that we fund, but not only the projects that we fund, but science in general, because society, and especially the Greek society, is paying really with high fund the role of the HFRI. Some of the milestones regarding the creation of the Hellenic Foundation, in just a few days, we will mark the 4 years after the legal framework for the establishment of the foundation was passed through the Hellenic Parliament. That date also marked the beginning of a marathon, I would say, but in a pace of a sprint. So we had to act really, really fast in order to deliver what we said we would do, what we actually promised. And that would be the support for the academic and research ecosystem in Greece. And we would do that quickly because we were in the middle back in 2016 in this really, really big financial and societal crisis. After a few months, the biggest, let's say, governing body of the foundation was established. And that was its General Assembly, which constituted back then by 36 universities and research centers. They were all named members of the General Assembly through open calls through the respective institutions that they represented. And then what they had to do was actually select the scientific council of the foundation through open calls. So in April 2017, we had the 9 members of the scientific council being appointed, all very distinguished scientists, not only in Greece, but internationally. The scientific council is the governing body of the most important, let's say, governing body of the foundation, who sets out the priorities, actually draws the policies, let's say, in order to support the excellent academic and research ecosystem. And the Scientific Council elected as well myself as the first director of the foundation in November 2017. That marked my marathon and in, let's say, the form of a sprint, which meant that I had the responsibility to build a foundation from scratch. And of course, we did not hesitate and we did not take any longer. Only 1 month after that, we rolled out the first call in order to support faculty members and researchers. The staff of the foundation back then was only 4 people. So in January 2018, the staff recruitment began in order to reach 35 people, which is the maximum capacity of workers that we can accommodate. In January 2019, we moved forward and we established a new electronic platforms in order to be able to submit, evaluate, and monitoring all the proposed projects, which is a very, very important tool as any institution internationally has. In September, we initiated the procedure to relocate the foundation as we were located in a very small building which could not accommodate our expansion and also secure a more safe and functional environment for our workers. And within the complete lockdown, we actually managed to relocate the foundations to its new building in Syncro Avenue. What I tried to describe was a bottom-up approach, where the academic and research community of the country will shape its destiny. Everyone who is participating in the governing bodies of the Hellenic Foundation for Research and Innovations are elected and are elected by the scientific, the academic and research community of Greece itself. That operation is very similar to the European Research Council, the iconic institution that the European Union has in order to support excellent curiosity-driven research, research endeavors that will let's say, try to overcome the barriers of human knowledge. So HFRI supports excellent science with no thematic or geographic exclusions. That is very important because usually sciences like the humanities or social sciences do not get funded very easily because, let's say, they don't have an obvious connection with business or the economy. But Greece, as we all know, and this conference has so vividly shown, is practically known everywhere in the world for its culture, for its civilization through the centuries. So it's really important to have a tool that will also support all the things that define us as Greece internationally. So in a bottom-up approach, the scientific community, let's say, draws these policies in order to support its own. HFRI, as I said, is governed by this 9-member scientific council, and its decisions are implemented by myself, by the director. I have the responsibility to implement the decisions drawn by the scientific council. Our budget, our initial budget, is 300 million euros. 120 million euros came from the Greek Public Investments Program, and 180 million came from the European Investment Bank, the EIB. I must say that we have secured this funding in total. We are the institution that hasn't lost a euro out of the available budget. And not only that, but we also secured additional funding from the Stavros Niarchos Foundation in order to support excellent Greek researchers who had excellent proposals submitted in the European Research Council, but did not get funded. I will say more about that in a bit. So, as any country that wants to support its excellent academic and research ecosystem, and as you see, here we have a lot of foundations that do exactly that, and not only a lot, but very, very important for the countries, must have an independent foundation that would fund curiosity-driven research. You see here the European Research Council that does exactly that, the National Science Foundation in the United States, the Royal Society in the United Kingdom, the DFG in Germany, the Swiss National Science Foundation in Switzerland, the National Natural Science Foundation of China, the National Research Council of Canada, and Science Foundation of Ireland are some of those institutions existing abroad. All these countries, I must say, have universities among the first 100 in the world, which is really, really important. And we can understand the connection between supporting the excellent ecosystem and being a leader in a global state, in a global environment. So what has been achieved so far? As you know, one important thing in order to have a sustainable support for the excellent academic and research ecosystem is to provide funding with consistency and continuity. And that's exactly what we have been trying to do for the very first day that we started. So the emphasis was in young scientists, so because they were the ones who were mostly vulnerable by the severe economic and societal challenges that Greece faced. So the first call for PhD scholarships was exited by the foundation, and we received more than 2,000 proposals for funding for PhD scholarships, which shows the really big need for support. We funded almost 600 PhD students for the first round, and with a budget of more than 13 million euros. The second call followed for PhD students. We received 1,327 proposals. We funded almost 400 with a budget of 10 million. So up to now, we have received almost 3,500 proposals for PhD students, and we have almost funded 1,000 PhD students in almost 2.5 years. and with a budget more than 23 million. Our third call for PhD scholarships is out and it finishes in a few days. Then came the research projects for postdoctoral fellows. The first one gathered more than 1,600 proposals for research projects, and we funded 192. The budget for that action was 34 million euros, and that was followed by the second call, which we gathered more than 1,000 proposals, and we funded just above 100 projects with a budget of more than 16.5 million euros. So the total applications for research projects regarding postdoctoral fellows almost reached 3,000, and we are funding so far 300 young researchers, postdoctoral fellows working in the universities and researchers of the country, with a total budget exceeding 50 million euros. Then came the calls for faculty members and researchers. The first call, the one that I said before, gathered almost 3,000 proposals. We funded 261 projects. These projects have budgets around 200,000 euros each, which is really, really important for them. And the total budget of the first call was 45 million euros. The second call followed. We received just above 2,000 applications. It's still under evaluation, though the first stage, because it's a two-stage process, has started rolling out results. The budget for that exceeded 24 million. So in total, we got almost 5,000 applications for from faculty members and researchers, and the total budget for those actions reached 70 million euros. As I said, we also rolled out calls for the acquisition of strategic research equipment. We got 324 proposals. We're in the stage where the funding agreement will be signed for 17 projects with a total budget of 20 million euros.
Mr. Nasikas, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you are aware of having only 2-3 minutes.
Yes, I will.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Yeah, I will just go through these actions. As I said, the action N97 by Theodore Papazoglou, he was actually the one who initiated that and is the action that the foundation has with the Stavros Niarchos Foundation. Up to now, we have more than 50 million. So HFRI has received and continues to receive for evaluation more than 20,000 proposals. We have funded at least 1,500 PhD students, postdocs, faculty, and researchers by ensuring consistency and continuity. And we have rolled out in just 2.5 years, almost 180 million. For those of you who are interested in learning more about our actions, the foundation issues regularly each year its work program. So by that work program, it's, let's say, the roadmap that the foundation will continue to support the excellent academic and research ecosystem of Greece. So with this final comment, I want to thank again the organizing committee for inviting me and all of you who attended my presentation. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Mr. Nasikas, and what a wonderful presentation. Actually, I have taken some notes here, you know, with the numbers and the mathematics you presented, and they are very, very hopeful, actually. I've noticed that you finance an average 25,000 euros per proposal for PhD, which is very reassuring for the young people and the scientists. But most importantly, 170,000 euros per average proposal on post-PhD and faculty research projects. Allow me the comment, wow, this is very, very hopeful. Thank you so much. I'm sure that we will have you for the 4 o'clock questions and answers. And now, thank you very much. And now I would like to introduce you to our next speakers. We have Dr. Konstantinos Kalemis, who is an instructor at the National Center for Public Administration and Local Government, and assigned at the Department of Primary Education in ECPA. He's a certified intercultural instructor of the Council of Europe and serves as the refugee educational coordinator of the Ministry of Education in Greece.
Good afternoon to everybody.
Good afternoon. Just hold on a second, Mr. Kalemis.
Yes, yes.
You will be joined with Dr. Maritsa Evangelia. Dr. Maritsa is Head of General Secretariat Division, Public Relations and Etiquette, and Secretary of the Hospital Board at the Athens Naval Hospital. She's also an instructor at the National Center for Public Administration and Local Government, but in adult education and lifelong learning. So both our speakers will share their knowledgeable inquiry on a most imperative systemic phenomenon, migration flows to Europe and their inclusion in national education systems of member states, challenges and perspectives. So Dr. Kalemis and Dr. Maritsa, the floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Allow me to thank you very much in the beginning for the opportunity you gave us to share our experience and plans. And I'm going to share my screen at the moment. I think that you can see me now, correct? Can you see my presentation?
Yes, absolutely, very correct. You can put it on presentation mode as well.
Correct. So as you just say, and we thank you very much for your presentation and your kind words, we are going to speak for a very recent problem and situation in Europe, which has to do with the migration flows so far and what is going to happen in the near future. First of all, I would make the first part, and Mrs. Maritsa will follow. I will make some presentation about the migration and refugees crisis in Europe, stating to the present situation, with a refer to the migration period so far in Europe, 3 major periods so far, and the trends of the global and European migration in the near future. Starting, this image is quite familiar to everybody. To us, since 2016, this image with a boat in a terrible situation, completely full with immigrants crossing Europe, Mediterranean seas, going from Turkey to the Aegean Islands and to Lampedusa in Italy or even to Spain, is a daily, that's something that appears daily. You can see that it's not so something new as a situation. Refugee crisis starting by the mid 90s, but it came to a peak in 2016 when we have nearly 1.5 million refugees coming from the Europe, from the borders from Asia and Africa to European Union countries, mainly to Greece, Italy, and Spain. What caused that? First of all, it was the instability in Syria. Then it was the booming there and the fear of life that forced millions of people to evacuate their countries and found ways to go outside the war. As you can see, the main routes, according to IOM, are from the north of Africa to Italy and from Turkey to Greece and from Greece to the European Union countries. Of course, we
Mr. Kalemis, excuse me 1 minute. I don't know if you are aware, we see only your first introductory slide.
I apologize.
Actually, I think you're speaking on the fourth, right?
Yes, so, I'm on the fourth.
Yes, I believe that you should put it in a presentation, in display.
Oh, I do apologize.
No, no, by all means.
I do apologize. My screen was changing, that's why. I do apologize. As you can see here, we have the main routes starting from the north of Africa, going to Italy mainly, and then from the east, from Turkey to Greece, and then through Greece to Central European Union countries. Let's see in short about the three periods of migration in Europe. We have three major periods. The first starts from just after the Second World War, when the movement of people within European countries has been booming economically, especially to the North European countries, when the industrial production was very high and they increased so much between 1953 and 1958. Just after that, we have very educated and specialized workers, and they transfer from their handwork to what we call the white collar work. Then we go to the second period, which starts from 1974 and comes near the end of the 80s. It is characterized by the oil crisis migration, which created specialized workers from Europe outside from the Europe, but also people with specific technical education coming inside Europe and prepare and getting the residency and the applying for the immigration policies in higher and easier ways. And then we go to the third period that comes from the 90s to 2012. In our country, it's an education part, it's the most characterized period of immigration, as we have movements from and to Europe. We have many political changes inside European countries, meaning the collapse of the Iron Curtain, the opening of borders of the Eastern Europe, all these, the Cold War in Yugoslavia, all these create flows of asylum seekers within European countries and mainly to Western European countries. What comes to today's situation? I'm putting the same image because we have as a reference point, we have the year 2015, when we have the applications about the asylum seekers, which is booming. And we can see that the ages from 0 to 13 and from 18 to 34 overcome nearly 5 million applications in a year. Today, if we speak in 2020, these numbers have been increased by 25 to 28%. This is mainly from countries with the origin from Afghanistan and Iran. Let's see what is the present situation.
Mr. Kalemis, I'm sorry again to interrupt you.
Yes.
You know, we all watched the very first slide of your presentation, so I believe that you have to take out the full screen and the presenter view and to again make display presentation.
All right.
I think it does not move because you have the full screen.
I apologize. I thought it was moving.
No, it was not.
Now, can you see the new slide?
Not really.
I don't know what's going on.
Don't worry, because perhaps it is coinciding with this phenomenon that you are presenting.
Probably, yes.
Yes.
Probably, yes.
So now we are watching you and Dr. Maritsa, so you can catch up with the presentation again.
Okay, I'll do so.
And share screen.
Yes, please.
Your presentation view. Just share screen.
Oh my God, I don't know what's going on.
Ah, now it has moved. Can you go forward? Fantastic. Fantastic.
Right. Let me go to the exact.
Fantastic.
Here.
Thank you all so right. much. Thank you.
I do apologize for the technical
do not.
Situation, but as Please you state, it's all right. Please now, we what we expect in the near future. According to a last visit I made in a research in 2019 in Lebanon, we find about with UNCHR and IOM that we have about a huge number, nearly to 4 million people ready to move, and that is a political pressure that Turkey poses at the moment, that forces European Union to make the new pact of migration and asylum with more, let's say, severe conditions to give it. So although that is, does not replace the double regulation, this pact reduces the pressure to the main country gates like Greece and Italy. Going further down, this graphic shows from what comes here to Europe. We have the whole East Asia coming here. Imagine that in the camps of Malakasa, where I have been assigned for 3 years, we had people even from Haiti and Nepal. So what is at the moment? The European Union, particularly Central and Eastern European states, are facing a difficult demographic situation in the beginning of the 21st century. The refugee crisis has come to a new stage in the last few decades, following some different politics from other countries. For example, European countries don't have a common way to react. Austria, for example, has reduced the entry of people seeking international protection to a few tens per day. And this was violating not only the Geneva Convention terms, but also the efforts that Germany, Greece, Italy, Spain, and in total European Union are trying to find a solution to that crisis. Then we have a big inflow that peaked to 2007. And as we can see, we just report that. And if we go here to the society background of the countries, we can see that compared to the beginning of the crisis, only Belgium, Germany, Sweden show percentage falls in their population, infant population. Southern European countries, especially Greece, Italy, Portugal, and Spain, have an increase to these percentages. This comes as the most recent reports from migration policy debates of the OECD. Then we have to keep in mind that the number of international migrants worldwide was grown faster than the world population. Can you imagine the percentage from 2.8% in 2000 to come to 3.4 in 2017? This makes significant changes within the regions. And this comes as an influence to the education systems, which Mrs. Maritsa will explain to you in details later on. As a final remark, much of the discussion about the scale of immigration focus of the asylum seekers and the stateless people. What comes to the reality is that a big percentage of them, that comes to 40 to 45%, are not in need of protection. There are illegal immigrant workers going inside the refugees, so they confuse the systems and make a sneaky way to enter in European Union. This is the end of my part. I do apologize for the technical mixed up, and I thank you very much again for your time.
We thank you very much as well. And we are expecting Dr. Maritsa now. Thank you.
Yeah, yes.
So, okay, thank you for having me. Can you see the share screening? Am I mostly sharing with you my screen? Yes?
No, we cannot see your share screen.
You cannot see. Okay, I'll do it once again.
Yeah. That's it. Now it goes smoothly. And you have to slideshow.
Okay, can you see it in a slideshow mode?
Excellent, excellent.
Okay, so thank you for having me. And let me just say at the beginning that since I'm a PhD candidate, I'm more a researcher and practitioner, and hopefully I will be announced as a doctor. So I'm going to, following to Dr. Kalemis' presentation, I'm going to dive into the meanings of the internationalization and globalization, intellectual capital in universities, educational complexity dynamics, and educational response to the refugee crisis. So let me introduce you to the context of this study. To begin with, the current framework is underpinned by the following remarks. The time period 2011-2016, universities are in the context of Greek fiscal consolidation. The fact that since 2015, we see Europe facing the worst refugee crisis since World War II, and now leaders in universities are called to support organizations' sustainability and adaptability. COVID-19 has sweeping changes across all universities. The aforementioned three crises have a common denominator, and that is the immense impact on human life that will lay there affecting communities, academics, scientists, students for far too long. To face up these challenges and increase the role of universities in the new knowledge-based economy, it will be necessary to develop intellectual capital models to reach the strategic objectives of universities. So, emerging sectors of economic activity require a workforce of multitasking education, multicultural education, as a continuous and intensive training. This reality also implies an overall redefinition of the cultural values of mankind and dictates new practices in all areas, and in particular, above all, in education. So the main question that arises is, are the key challenges in developing a new era of internationalization are the key challenges in developing a new era of internationalization within universities? What are the key challenges? So, internationalization refers to the increasing importance of international trade, international relations, treaties, alliances. Internationalization is being between and or among nations. The basic unit remains the nations, even as relations among the nations become increasingly necessary and important. On the other hand, globalization refers to a global economic integration of many formerly national economies into a global economy, mainly by free trade, free capital mobility, but also by easy and uncontrolled migration. It is an effective erasure of national boundaries for economic purposes. International trade becomes interregional trade. What was many becomes one. There is a reciprocity between these two meanings, but still are not the same. The intensification of student mobility that may result from an institutional strategy to increase overseas student recruitment contributes to the further intensification of globalization. Intensified curriculum internationalization processes will result in making the university educational product more attractive and therefore help to increase student mobility in recruitment markets. So once universities are out in the system, like through exchanging ideas or programs internationally, then progressively they become global. So intellectual capital is consisting of three basic, strongly interrelated, intangible elements, and that is human capital, structural, and relational. We need to see human capital through the lens of investing in both formal and informal education and training, which has fruitful results on individual productivity by providing a wider understanding, skills, attitudes, and motivation necessary for economic and social development. Structural capital refers to explicit knowledge related to the internal process of dissemination, communication, and management of scientific and technical knowledge in the organization. It is related to corporate structures, technical developments, patents, licenses, software, databases, and relational capital gathers the wide set of economic, political, and institutional relationships between the university and its non-academic partners, enterprises, non-profit organizations, local government, society in general. The paradigm of relational capital is industrial PhDs. The Hellenic Federation of Enterprises on October 2019 has announced that the total number of PhDs has tripled since 2000. Yet universities' lack of formal processes of an indirect involvement of business entities in the actualization means of a doctoral dissertation, like provision of consumables, use of laboratories, industrial equipment, or facilities of the company. So there are rare and non-systematic attempts in this direction. Okay. It is the rise of competition among universities that demands an intellectual capital evaluation. So let's keep in mind that global also means being adaptive, flexible, and multilingual. Intellectual capital has a significant importance for obtaining a competitive advantage for the capacity of an organization to create value. It is a strategic, starting point for better academic management of intellectual capital. It reduces risk of brain drain. It is based on prolepsies, and it is like looking through different lenses that allow us to see what happens in the university from the knowledge development point. So a conceptualization of the intra-organizational process could look like somehow like that. Universities should develop human resource protocols for their human capital so as to create organizational knowledge. And that knowledge can be directed through effective pathways via knowledge-based strategies. The latter can mainly be achieved through lifelong learning that will enhance individual competencies of academic research students, making it easier to dive into strong and qualitative relationships of exchanging knowledge and thus creating everlasting series of human capital as part of the intellectual capital. Why intellectual capital? Reports will lead universities to reflections and long-term planning, thus preventing us from acting only on a crisis mode upon the refugee influx. We have an insight into their level of performance. It is a benchmarking methodology and brings present researchers closer to the requirements of the public and the industry by introducing a common language. Universities are considered critical institutional actors in national innovation systems. Moreover, people in the university societies are in a state of openness to new information. The system is unlocked now. So changes like fast adopting of new technologies, e-classes, virtual lifelong learning for the personnel, new external market and scientific partnerships can be poised faster than ever, driving successful implementation of the intellectual capital monitoring through several indicators measuring how to make in Europe a more attractive place to invest and work, knowledge and innovation for growth. And all this can result in creating more and better jobs and recognizes that knowledge and innovation are the engines of a sustainable growth. The European area of knowledge should enable undertakings to create new competitive factors for consumers to benefit from new goods and services and for the workforce to acquire new skills. Let me remark here that all the changes need to be institutionalized and become part of the new system before it is relocked. We can and return to the new normality. So the needs and capabilities of organizations vary. It is not like a one-size-fits-all data exchange situation. So each university adopts its own ways of fast and quality adaptation to the current situations. And the current situations are complex because universities are getting pressures from all over the system: market, technology, pandemic, fiscal consolidation, artificial intelligence, refugee crisis. There is a need to create a connectionist era between immigrants' arrivals and the residents of each European country. Greece should presently consider the educational gap, given the fact that even prior to the immense migration influx in 2010-2011 school year, 59,000 foreign and repatriated pupils attended the primary schools of the country, out of which only 5% of pupils attended classes for children from abroad. If society cultivates seeds in the primary schools by inclusive school practices, it will harvest intellectual capital the years to come, and adaptive channels of cross-connection with universities will be opened up. For refugees who have already received an education, it's vital to recognize that this is part of their identity. For example, some Syrian refugees arrived with remarkable IT skills in Europe and meet the workforce need. So it's time to reforming the university education by fostering high-level investment and ensure reduction disparities, create better equipment and more flexible systems to handle anticipated remarkably high enrollments of new international students, allowing conflicting and connecting to happen through exploratory dialogue that can open up adaptive spaces where academics will enable students with innovative ideas to have voice. Support refugee crisis by allowing network in the connectivity of academics and students by fostering partnerships between institutions in the Middle East and universities in Europe, the European Recognition Manual for higher Education Institutes that has been developed as part of the European Area of Recognition project, is a manual that contains shared standards and clear guidelines on all aspects of the recognition of foreign qualification, including the recognition of refugees. Their passion, sharing knowledge, and make use of their position of influence, create spaces of access via internet networks in the universities, and allow immigrant non-students to easily attend free lectures or granted access to digital libraries. Open access to higher education for refugees will enable displaced citizens to return with skills and knowledge, engineering, medicine, smoothly back into their society as political stability returns to their homeland. So Dr. Kalemis and myself have prompted this work in order to map the current crisis situation in the complex context within which we are and see the future of higher education through the lens of opportunities and challenges. To sum up, the aftermath of do not waste a good crisis is that universities which are in the specific complex crisis frame are poised to change and adopt new educational protocols, new processes in their everyday practices, because globalization and crisis are pushing the systems to change. And part of that change is the emergence of a new interdisciplinary and multicultural educational processes for current and for future crises. So thank you for having me. And I hope I can get some questions and answers at the end of the
You can, Dr. Maritsa, you can put off the screen share.
Yes,
screen share. Yes, that is okay now.
I'm okay.
Yes, absolutely. We can see you
absolutely
now.
Absolutely, pleasure. Thank you.
And we thank you very much for both Dr. Kalemis and you, Dr. Maritsa, for your very detailed presentations. I'm sure that we can catch up with your main idea, especially on the last slides, bridges. You spoke about bridges on the last slides and how to create bridges. And also, if I may add, something very interesting from your presentation was the need for social ID contexts and interaction, cultural interactions between immigrants, mostly younger immigrants, and the Greek society or European societies. Ever so intriguing issues, those. Thank you very much. Allow me to pass on now to our last speaker for the session of humanity, and to introduce you Mrs. Stratis Panourios, who is a professional theater and cinema director, actor and writer. He studied film directing at the University of Greenwich, London, and theater directing and acting at the National Theater of Greece. A TEDx Athens speaker and the author of many writings in multiple publications, Mr. Panourios has been awarded internationally for its entire work. Well, our speaker now will introduce us to artificial intelligence and its connection with the most humane condition, that of drama. What a connection. Artificial intelligence and autodrama. The case of Darfsteller, if I pronounce it correctly, Mr. Panourios. The floor is yours, please.
In a future world, actors have been replaced by humanoids. Their director and manipulator is an artificial intelligent computer called the Maestro, which directs the performances by constantly interacting between the humanoid actors and the viewers. The theater, as we knew it, it is dead. For many years, actors have recalled the rights of their faces and voices for a significant amount of money to a multinational entertainment company that now manages the theatrical shows worldwide. The new art form that abolished the term theater or drama was called Autodrama or Autotheater, which means the automatic theater that operates with specific programming of artificial intelligence. Technically, humanoid actors are perfect, but they lack something very, very important, the feeling, the artistic breath and emotion of creation elements that only the technically imperfect human actors had in the past. In this novel, written in 1955, the American author Walter Miller Jr. places the above story at the beginning of the 21st century. The protagonist is a former famous actor who belonged to the called Darfsteller actors. Darfsteller is a German a word meaning the emotional actor, the self-directed actor. Darfstellers were the actors who were able to completely identify themselves with the role that they were playing, as opposite to the common Schauspieler, actors who performed their role by using only the technique, methodology, which is external without emotion, as it is called in the theatrical language. The hero of this novel, Ryan Thornier, is an explosion not only from an artistic passion, but mainly from a humanity and an existential justification. The former actor who now cleans the theater for living, cleans the theater for living, will create the conditions for his reappearance on the theatrical stage, playing together with the humanoids in a play that once he was triumph. And from this moment until his majestic departure from the stage, the spectator watches the anguished course of the human actor who suffers trying to complete his last performance, the last performance of a human being on this planet, the last performance of his world as he knew it, trying to complete his existence and his mission, thus interpreting his existence in a world that now artificial intelligence has replaced him. Miller's work in perhaps the only text in the history of utopians or dystopian texts that places art at its core, namely the most living art of the theater, of the arts, the theater. The other texts we know deal with the delicate balances of society in general. We will mention some of these texts and their authors that we believe Miller was influenced by. Some of futuristic texts, fantasy literature, science fiction, the utopians of past centuries unfolding in unknown continents, countries, and states, such as the Republic of Plato, The Utopia by Thomas More, the novels of Jules Verne, along with the prophetic texts of H.G. Wells, Aldous Huxley, and George Orwell's landmark work, 1984. In this novel, 1984, one of the most famous dystopias of the last century, the author presents a future controlled by the dominant figure of the Big Brother, with the party controlling the meanings of the words, of history, and of the collective memory of the people. In another novel by Pohl Frederick and Combrich MC, The Space Merchants, written in 1953, reveals a future dominated by advertising companies. The concept of citizens have been replaced by the concept of consumer. Members of parliament represent not constituencies, but companies. Inequalities are absolute, the environment is polluted, and the commonly accepted proverbs are political power refines. Absolute political power refines absolutely, and it's better 1,000 innocent people to suffer than guilty person to escape. This is also science fiction quotes. Continuing in another dystopian novel with Folded Hands by Jack Williamson, robots having as a main command in their programming to protect human establish a benevolent and ruthless dictatorship where happiness is imposed by the punishment of phlebotomy. During the first months of 2020, theaters worldwide were closed due to measures to control the coronavirus pandemic. Theater suddenly ceased to exist as a form of art. After the initial freeze from the closure of theaters, cinematic or television hybrids began to appear in our TV or computer screens, videotaped or streamlined. Performances tried to keep or simulate some of the magic atmosphere of the theatrical world. By this, the only thing that was achieved, it was to reinforce the viewer's desire to see a live performance and not a show through the screen of a mobile phone. Theater as a child in democracy is the act that created the dialogue. Ancient Athens during the Golden Age was the birthplace of the theatrical act based on writing poetic texts organized upon specific aesthetic rules. From the time of the ancient tragic poets until today, theater has experienced many adventures. It has gone through various fluctuations and changed in many phases. Behind all this, sometimes that has remained in unchanged until today, and it will remain so. As long as there are people on earth and it continues man's desire to communicate with his peers through some form of expression, which is not recorded in everyday life, as well as man's mood to succumb to the magic world of a piece of art which is sculpted in front of his eyes and that refers directly to the human existence, theater will continue to live. Theater represents the public discourse. It is the mirror of society which is regenerated in the space of the stage, repeating the experiment of the human adventure. In the world of artistic spectacles, such as cinema, television, dance, the main interest of creation is the man who presents an important or an insignificant story of some human beings. Theater, in this respect, is the most genial of all artistic spectacles, as it refers to the dramatic hero who is the man himself by using the psychosomatic reaction of human through the actors in real time and in front of real people, the spectators. According to theater researcher Hara Bakonikola, the theatrical stage gives the spectator the opportunity to turn his or her gaze to any contribute of object or part of the space he's wishing at any time. On the contrary, cinematographic camera restricts the viewer's eye dictatorially, forcing it with the respective point of view chosen by the director, and with the zoom technique, gradual approach or removal of the lens for person or object to see only what the camera and therefore the director sees. In the dramatic art, logos is the base and the beginning of its essence. Logos, which is dressed the human being and it's expressed through the psychosomatic expressions. The theater concerns with the journey to an inner and invisible human land. where all thoughts, emotion, feelings, imagination, dreams, fantasies, secrets, ambitions, hopes, fears, all our affections, speculation, wanderings, all our longings, our likes, dislikes, all are themselves invisible. They constitute oneself. All these are the theater world. Theater explores the invisible. Realize the invisible as it creates emotions. It is a method of producing emotions which are experienced by a group of people at the same time, the audience, the spectators. Next May in Athens, I will direct a play entitled The Last Performance of the World, a theatrical performance based on the novel Darfsteller by Walter Miller Jr. Nikos Gelelis will be the only actor. The same show will be able to perform as well in English and French, in a way to appeal to more and more spectators, making maybe a world tour. In addition, this story will be shot in a movie in France, in French. In the research we made for this performance, we met Sophia. Sophia is a social humanoid robot developed by Hong Kong-based company Hanson Robotics. The robot's creator, Dr. David Hanson, believes that by 2035, androids will surpass nearly everything that humans can do. A new generation of androids will be able to pass university exams and PhDs and functions with the intelligence levels of an 18-year-old human. These advances machines will go on to start what Dr. Hanson calls the global robotic civil rights movement. The movement itself is expected to happen in 2038 and will be used to question the ethical treatment of artificial intelligence machines with the human society. But it won't be until the year 2045 that the global robotic civil rights movements will have pushed to the Western world to recognize androids as living entities, with the United States being the first country to grant them full civil rights, including the right to marry both people and other robots. I don't know if at that time we or our grandchildren will experience the first performance in Epidaurus of an ancient tragedy with humanoids. I also don't know if android people will sit on the spectate, android people will sit in spectatorship. Theater lasted for 2,500 years. I think it is unlikely that it will die, as no art ever dies. Science fiction does not play the role of a prophet. Its basic technique is to examine the consequences that a scientific discovery or a technological innovation would have in society of man. These texts create exercises. On paper for the tomorrow land, on this planet, they provoke questions that sometimes coincide with reality. The tomorrow phobia is more than inappropriate and perhaps dangerous in our time. We must stand in front of tomorrow with our minds open to risks and its magic. After all, theater will survive with its rules and its magic in all utopias or dystopians of the future. Thank you very much. I hope that the city of Athens will soon become the cultural capital of all the Athens in this world and beyond.
And I would like to invite you all to participate. We have some questions. First of all, let me share with you Mr. Kalokerinos, Professor Kalokerinos' question to Dr. Maritsa. Dr. Maritsa, can we absorb academically and socially all refugees?
So I have written answer as well. Globalization and the refugee crisis within it, because globalization refers to the exchange of international students. And now with the refugee crisis, we have a faster way of international students within our universities. So it's a new strong dynamic in Greek universities. Maybe other European countries were had faced that previously with international students, much more international students enrollments. And it's going to escalate in the years to come. So I suppose that we need an operational response rather than a response by order. And I say this because we have seen organizations in Greece acting by a bureaucratic and in a hierarchical way. There's nothing bad in this, but in a crisis, we need to have an operational response and not a response by order. The current systems will not be able to get us out of this crisis or the events that are upcoming in the next years.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Maritsa. We have...
Maybe Professor Kalemis would like to comment on that as well.
Yes, I would like to add to what my colleague said, Mrs. Maritsa, that we have a great number of university certified refugees. We had, let's say, people from Turkey who were professors there, educators, certified managers, which came here due to the political situation in Turkey. And these people are entering to the Greek market. Also, we have people from Afghanistan, Cameroon, Gambia, with university degrees, and some of them also have master degrees. This is the next step to make through DOATAP a recognition of their documentation, and probably as OTE at the moment is doing, it has get some of those technicians from Syria and Afghanistan as technician staff in his working staff. So it's a new condition which have been to be considered to the near future. Because so far we say that the education comes from 4 years to 15 years old, and from 15 and up, we do nothing. But in this area, above 18 and 20 years old, we have people with university degrees, certified technicians, everybody. And of course, the education that a refugee has got in his own country of origin is not left behind, comes with him. It's the intellectual capital that comes here as well. And we don't measure it, and we don't produce it, and we don't use it here.
Thank you. Dr. Kalemis and Maritsa, there is another question from Mr. Himi. What are the factors that make migration different today than, say, 30 years ago?
I just put on the chat the reply to this question.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, yes. But allow me to say that today we have...
In a nutshell.
Yes, too many data about the migration, too much information provided in this area that we didn't have many years ago. Also, we have different situations globally in the political area, in the financial area, in everything. All this have changed the numbers and the ways. And as I said in my presentation, we have the immigrants, we have the refugees, and we have the illegal immigrants. Three different parts. The common thing is that they enter in Greece and then to the European Union countries from the main gate. So it is easy for us to say that everybody is illegal immigrants, but it's not true.
It is not true. Thank you so much for that. Yes, Dr. Maritsa, please.
Thank you. May I add on that, that technology is very different nowadays. 30 years ago, we did not have that internet interconnectivity across all the countries. So that changes the map of interconnection of globality around the world. That's why the refugee influx that we face in Greece can be positively be engaged in our systems. Internet and the new technologies is a tool that we can use, and that is an advantage. Okay, 30 years ago we did not have those tools.
Yes, absolutely.
And much more other tools, but those tools of internet and
absolutely
fast interconnectivity across the globe.
Very good. Thank you very much for that. We have a question for Mr. Kosteletos. He's with us. Very good. Mr. Kosteletos, during your presentation and speech, the two last points out of the five about holistic thinking, I think that they have not been covered efficiently. Idea as an open system and cosmos as environment. Can you elaborate a bit on those two points? Idea and cosmos. Please open your sound, unmute yourself. Thank you.
It's okay now, eh?
Yeah.
Let's start from cosmos. Cosmos is the new foundation we have to dwell upon and abandon as well later. Cosmos is not a cosmos physical nature like the ancient paradigm, but is a cosmos with a capital K that involves both material and spiritual. There is no distinction between material and spiritual. So cosmos is a place of reference, as I said, who dwell upon poetically, as Hedelin said. Cosmos changes as we change. It's a foundation without foundation, a nothing, everything experience, a game between existence and non-existence, that does not permit or imply any privilege of any kind. So what does it mean this? What would be a further explanation? For instance, freedom is just a motion in space. You are free. You are not condemned to be free, as Sartre said, but because you are not free. So you are not free. That's why you are free. This is the new idea in this opening in cosmos. You are not free, that's why you are free. That is what I want to say is you play is a place of to play, but this plane is a ground and you cannot be outside the ground. You always be playing under rules in a ground, and these rules are not are the conditions of your freedom. So you are free and not being free at the same time. In order to be free, you have not to be free. This is the cosmos. So cosmos, it has to be understood. It is important, the idea to be understood as an environment, not exactly environment. Environment is a reference to the physical, better as a surrounding maybe, or better as a milieu that releases us from the idea of substance, certainties, fears or patterns or habitual tendencies that reproduce our neuroses, so to speak. This is the idea of milieu. There is no thing in itself. There are things in a milieu, in an environment. They are free in space. This is the new idea of entering into cosmos.
Very good. Thank you. So
the second yes. question is about the open systematic, the idea as an open systematic. Okay? So yes. What is this? As I begin to say in my lecture, you're in your home, and you have guests, and there is nothing to eat, and you need some kind of food. So there is no need. You have not cooked. There's no preparation. You have not cooked anything. So you order a pizza from the outside to come in, so you can to host your guests. Okay. So what is this pizza? Somebody needs to be a vegetarian. Another one needs some meat. The other prefers just tomato. What are you going to do? There's only one pizza. Everybody will take just a small piece. It's okay. So what can you do to be okay, to accommodate different preferences, different desires? So you say to your order, just make me a ground, a piece with tomato, just another one. You can integrate the desires in the pizza. So everybody can take a desire, the preferred. Portion, refer piece of pizza. You understand? The whole pattern is a little bit chaotic, but it's at the same time organized. This is what I call an orderly adverb, orderly house. It's chaotic and at the same time is ordered. This is what's an open systematic. It's like the circle that the Zen masters always draw, which is a circle, but too many brushes. One brush at the same time, and always open. There is always a point that, like water, is throws out. You cannot catch it. It's you cannot catch this point. There was a missing point. Yes. This is an open systematic, organized, chaotic at the same time, but a point is always missing, like Platonic agathon, which is outside essence. Always missing and gives glimpses to our intuition. I don't know if.
Thank you so much. Also, we had a very nice attribution from Dr. Maritsa, saying that cosmos begins with CO, you know, the Latin loan from the Greek sin. So that is why it is so deeply inclusive. And cosmos comes with all, the whole creation. And from that whole holism drive us to your paradigm of holistic thinking, correct?
Yes, but you see, we have to integrate the old ancient physical paradigm. You know, from the ancient people, Plato, Heraclitus, Stoic, in China, Taoist, whatever, everything gets its importance in the physical horizon. The gods are physical powers. Everything is physical, is under physis. And just you have to, that comes in cycles, and you have to appreciate this coming up and down. This is the idea of the ancient, but after that we have the medieval, the theocentric, God-centering paradigm that say that you have to seek outside nature. This is also very important. After that came the anthropocentric, man-centered, the paradigm after Renaissance and the modern world that say that man was put in as a crux point in man's thought. Yeah. So we have to overcome all these three paradigms in order to move in the cosmos-centric area.
Mr. Kosteletos, do you consider that the anthropocentric paradigm will continue to exist
in
the 21st century?
Of course, yes. Sure, and 21st century as well. Mm-hmm. This paradigm is not so easy to abandon. It has to make its movement to go through the 21st century, but we have in mind what I have already said. It's so difficult to overcome the subject and the foundation, the main foundation, the two, in my opinion, main points of the anthropocentric paradigm. But anthropocentric is not humanistic. It's not the same.
No, it's not the same. No.
the word anthropocentric is what you put in your mind as first. You put nature, you put God, you put man, or you put cosmos. This is the main question.
Absolutely.
Humanism is on the way. It will come as a new humanist, baby. God will come as sacredness. Nature will come as you invite nature, but you cannot go to nature as the romantic idea. You cannot go to God. You invite God. You invite nature. You invite man in the new cosmocentric paradigm. You invite all the rest. You don't go to them. This is the difference.
Thank you so much for that. And allow me to put a question to Professor Oikonomidis. Professor Oikonomidis, you ended up your lecture, your presentation with a symbolic prototype of icona of citizens. We need you to portray to us this icona. How could we reach such a prototype, through pain or through courage? Please elaborate.
The word icon, symbolically speaking, the symbolic icon of the anthropos that I should be. In order to be anthropos, according to what I said during the lecture, we have to be citizens. We cannot be anthropoi without being citizens first, polites. Since we are not out there in the wilderness, living alone or in a wild way of life, but we are living actually inside communities, well organized, somehow organized, which means that this element, which is very important, politically and philosophically speaking, gives us the possibility of the political expression of ourselves. Our icon is through the image of us polites. Polites means members of a politia. And we find this in both Plato and Aristotle, of course, in later thinkers as well. That in order to exist, and to exist successfully, without killing one the other, or without anarchy, or without destruction and big damage, we have to live in organized comae first, and then in more, elevated types of society, such as the classical meaning of polis, which today should be translated as state, kratos. Now, in modern terms, but in modern terms. Now, this is the problem here, and that's why I decided to expose all these thoughts related to Athens as not a really existed polis, but as the idea of a really existed polis, the ideal of the polis, of the state, of the kratos. Now, but this cannot exist without, as I said, the population. And the population shouldn't be others than the citizens. Ruled and ruling. Archontes ke archomenoi. Now, question becomes more difficult to approach with the modern, with the now conditions of life, political firstly, globally, all over the world. We understand this. Other speakers analyzed very well what I'm saying now as well. And the difficulty is this big problem that we are facing. The big problem is to stay citizens, atoma, individuals or to become anonymous components of an enormous mass. Now, in order to get out of there, we have to reapproach the icona, the image, the icon of ourselves. But how? Who could lead us to go there? It's the past? Is it the antiquated way of thinking, as some modern professors and others believe that it is? The antiquated way of thinking, such as the very old one, the Platonic, or the Aristotelian? It's Athens again that could give the answer. Let's go back to Athens, to that symbolic Athens of her citizens, in order to understand what could be the way, which would be the way for reacting to this globalization, to this kingdom of the mass. Individuals and Atoma was the biggest conquest ever made. To feel different, but always acting together, if this is possible, but to understand our personal identities. Otherwise, there is no sense even to exist, according to Plato. Now, my difficulty as a professor, as a teacher of archaeology, but not just archaeology, as philosophy of the archaeology, as philosophy of the past as well, or as even as proper philosophy, I dare say, is that I'm talking to new members of this hyper society, which is the today's world, because we don't understand each other, since in order to have the image of Athens, of that symbolic Athens, you have to study first. You have to study it, to study her, to study the icon, not just to watch it, or not just to have some simple, you know, sounds coming, coming through all these centuries, all these millennia. Things that are absolutely modern, not antiquated, old, or passé. So, this is the use of the icon, of the icona of ourselves, that I presented to all of you earlier.
Well, thank you so much for this. It was much more than we expected. Thank you, Professor Oikonomidis. During the interval, I had the chance to call Professor Gouliamos in Nicosia, in Cyprus. There are a couple of questions to him, but unfortunately, he is giving a lesson now to the to Chinese university through the internet, so he is not able to be with us. There is one last question from Professor Kalokerinos to Dr. Nasikas, to Professor Nasikas. I'm not sure which is the question. That's why, Mr. Chairman, so we don't have Professor Kalokerinos, but we have Professor Himis with us.
Hello again.
Yes.
It's time to wrap up.
Time to wrap up, yes.
I'll try to wrap up my session and then I'll invite you to continue with your session, and then we conclude.
Yes,
I suppose the way we do it.
This is my understanding. Yes.
All right. So I took a look. I listened carefully to all the presentations of this last session, and I also took a look to the sessions or the previous sessions, and I see that there are common themes. For instance, in session technology, there were presentations on artificial intelligence, on sustainable development. Sustainable development is an issue of environment. In the session environment, we had presentations on technologies, on clear energy technologies, again, digital transformation. So we see that all sessions, technology, society, health, environment, economics, and humanity are all interconnected. And it couldn't be otherwise once we talk about man and his creations. So all of these are creations of man. Wrapping up my session, I could stay to four themes: culture, health, democracy, ethics, and leadership. I take these two, ethics and leadership, together. And I think that coming from a background of corporate social responsibility, what is interesting is that finally the bottom line is the responsible citizen. This is what you were talking about just now.
Absolutely.
The bottom-up approach is something very important, and it cannot be done in practice if we don't have responsible citizens. Responsible citizens in every profession. We as academicians, practitioners, every profession, we should try to transfer the information upwards. Otherwise, we cannot expect ministers and prime ministers to take the right decision. It's not the prime minister or presidents of the countries are not gods. They need to have the information, and the information comes from us, comes from people in practice, in their businesses, in everyday business. So responsibility, active citizenship, and bottom-up approach is, I think, the most important keys that I would like to share with you, not only regarding my session, but generally.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much. I will try to recapitulate, to wrap up what we have touched in our session. And if you allow me, I will do it with a very simple image in front of me. The whole body of humanity in our theme, it is consisted of three parts: the head, the logos, the soma, the middle part, the pathos, and our earth, standing on the earth, on the matter. So, in our, if you follow up the image, to our own logos, we had Mr. Kosteletos with his reflections of the anthropocentric view, a much more anthropocentric need for viewing humanism and humanity in this 21st century. Then, we have been escorted with a very essential thought, thinking by Professor Oikonomidis and his human conscience, the rediscovery of the Athens human consciousness, this image, this vision of consciousness. Then at the pathos part of our session, it was Professor Gouliamos is sharing him, stating that we have to really fight or to stand against the new enlightenment, in brackets, the new enlightenment which goes for an artificial and instrumental usage of mankind, of atomo. So Professor Gouliamos posed two central questions at the end of his presentation. how really literature and art could act as cultural means. How could we use, what would be the utilization of culture and art in this new paradigm against the new Enlightenment? And of course, how to create a mental and ontological synthesis. So, Professor Himi, we agree with what you have already shared about from the previous sessions. Lastly, we had our contributors at the grounding level of our session, and those were Dr. Nasikas with the knowledge-based building and support. We had Drs. Kalemis and Maritsa illustrating this vast phenomenon of migration with very much detail, very much input. And of course, at the end, we had an existential closing. Mr. Panourios, with this experiential kind of contribution to our conference, posed an important moment, an important image, if you allow me, the last performance of the actor, which will be the last performance of the actor, or which will be the psychosomatic experience of society through the theater from now onwards. So he posed an existential issue here. These are all, if you allow me the time to recapitulate, this is what we had concluded in our session, Mr. Chairman.
I would like to thank Dr. Vayiakakos and Dr. Himis, who is here, as the moderators for today. And I also want to thank all moderators, because I think we have all done a very good job. I watched all lectures of this conference. I was surprised by the high level of all presentations. I was surprised by the excellent discussions during the Q&A sessions. In fact, I realized that the time we gave to the Q&A sessions was not enough. So maybe, yes, okay, we are learning. I was surprised by the level of presentations. I think we had only one lecture which had to cancel the presentation, which is a great success of the conference. As a matter of fact, I think that the whole conference was very interesting. I enjoyed every moment of it. I have concluded that some sciences like technology, like medicine, like computer sciences are running very fast. They offer us a lot of things, but at the same time, we forget many things. We tend to be isolated, especially now with the pandemic. It's okay to see you on your computer, but we don't shake hands and we cannot talk to each other having a coffee. And this is something which I miss. I hope that during the second conference, we will have the time to chat, not through computer, but to chat with a cup of coffee or tea. In fact, I believe that this was a very nice conference. I would like to thank the organizing committee, and also I would like to thank Dr. Psathas for the excellent idea, for asking me to join the organizing committee, like Professor Vayiakakos, like Professor Bosco, who I think is still here. And it's my great honor to present to you.
Everybody.
Okay. It is very, I am very, and Mr. Papadopoulos is here, who was part of the organizing committee from the first beginning. It is my great honor now to introduce to you Dr. Psathas, whose idea of Athens called Athens, it's what we share today. I will ask Dr. Psathas to give us the last speech of this conference. George, go on, please.
Φίλες και φίλοι, η Αθήνα, καλή Αθήνα οίκια, ολοκλήρωσε με επιτυχία το πρώτο διεθνές διαθηναϊκό διαεπιστημονικό συνέδριο με τίτλο «Άνθρωπος και τα δημιουργήματά του». Σε αυτό το σημείο θέλω να ευχαριστήσω τους καθηγητές και τους ερευνητές για τις τόσο σημαντικές ομιλίες τους. Θέλω να ευχαριστήσω επίσης την Οργανωτική και Επιστημονική Επιτροπή για την καθοριστική συμβολή στην επιτυχία του συνεδρίου. Ιδιαίτερα δε τον πρώην αντιπρίτανη και πρόεδρο του συνεδρίου, κύριο Αντώνη Καλοκαιρινό, καθώς και τον οργανωτικό διευθυντή και σύμβουλο, στρατηγό κύριο Ευθύμιο Χαροκόπο. Επίσης, όλους τους χορηγούς του συνεδρίου, καθώς και τους θεσμούς που μας εμπιστεύτηκαν τις αιγίδες τους. Αγαπητές φίλες και φίλοι, ολοκληρώνεται η πρώτη 20ετία του 21ου αιώνα. Η ανθρωπότητα ζει την έναρξη μιας ιστορικής περιπέτειας που δεν γνωρίζει ακόμη κανείς που θα οδηγήσει. Ο μεγάλος μας φιλόσοφος Κορνήλιος Καστοριάδης έλεγε ότι την μοναδική ελπίδα για το μέλλον αποτελούν δύο παράγοντες. Η πολιτική εγρήγορση και η δραστηριότητα των λαών. Κλείνοντας, καλούμε τους συμμετέχοντες και τους θεσμούς να στηρίξουν τις μελλοντικές πρωτοβουλίες και δράσεις της Αθήνα Καλή Αθήνα Οίκη, καθώς η πόλη της Αθήνας, η πόλη μας, θα συνεχίζει να λάμπει μέσα από τις εξαίρετες δραστηριότητες των πολιτών της και μέσα από τις ανάσες των προγόνων της, ζητώντας μια θέση στο μέλλον. Σας ευχαριστώ.
Thank you very much, George. I think we can all say goodbye now and hope to see you all in the second Interdisciplinary Inter-Athenian Conference Manages Creation. Thank you very much for joining us. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.